بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه من والاه. So inshallah we'll try to finish the part that talks about masajid today if possible. The next point mentioned in this chapter is the fact that it was the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to sit after the morning salah till sunrise, and that is based on the hadith narrated by Jabir ibn Samura, that Prophet ﷺ, after he prayed the morning salah, he used to sit until sunrise. He wouldn't be talking to anybody, but he wouldn't really mind if people talk to each other, because it says here, فَإِذَا طَلَعَتْ شَمْسْ قَامَ وَكَانُوا يَتَحَدَّثُونَ فَيَأْخُذُونَ فِي أَمْرِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ فَيَضْحَكُونَ وَيَبْتَسِمُ. Some people would be maybe talking, chatting, that's okay as well. فَيَتَحَدَّثُونَ فِي أَمْرِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. They used to try to remember, oh, we used to do this in Jahiliyyah. Oh, and they start laughing. And he, of course, he would hear them. And sometimes he would smile when he hears these stories. Also, I would like to mention the other hadith, which is that whoever sits until sunrise, this hadith, people have differed whether it is authentic or not. The hadith says, whoever sits till sunrise and does two rak'at, then he gets the reward of Hajjah and Umrah, a complete Umrah and Hajjah. 50-50, yani scholars have differed is it even authentic or not, and it is weak. On its own, it's a weak hadith. Some scholars said that it is hasanun li ghayri. We can accept it not because of it alone, but because of other supporting evidence. This could be one of the supporting evidence as well. But the supporting evidence indicates the practice itself, which is to sit to sunrise. But the reward, we can't really say that whoever sits till sunrise gets this kind of reward. Now, also, so this is a good time to sit in the masjid. And the other good time that is also mentioned in the sunnah, they used to sit in the masjid, is between Maghrib and Isha. And that's actually the practice of many Muslims nowadays anyhow, after Fajr and between Maghrib and Isha. There's a hadith on this matter that the Sahaba were sitting between Maghrib and Isha. Prophet came back to them after he prayed Maghrib and left. He came back. وَقَدْ حَفَزَهُ النَّفَسْ مُسْرِعًا. He was in a bit of a hurry, and to the extent that he was breathing a bit heavy. And وَقَدْ حَسَرَ عَنْ رُكْبَتَيْهِ. As if he were also lifted his, to walk in a fast pace, he had lifted his garment so he doesn't trip. So he came back to them almost like running. And this is a hadith that is Sheikh Al-Albani considered as sahih. It's in Sunan Ibn Majah. He said to them, إن أبشروا هذا ربكم قد فتح بابا من أبواب السماء يباهي بكم الملائكة يقول انظروا إلى عبادي قد قضوا فريضة وهم ينتظرون أخرى. He says, I wanted to give you the good news or glad tidings that your Lord has opened a gate to the heavens, praising you in front of the malaika, the angels, telling them, look at my slaves and servants, they have completed a fard, and now they are waiting for another fard, another mandatory salah. So these are the two times that Muslims frequently sit in the masjid. Also, the masjid has to be cleaned. And that's obvious, of course. Any sacred place has to be cleaned. And of course, the fragrance of the masjid should be good. Muslims should do their utmost best to keep the masjid clean and beautiful. Now, there's a woman who used to clean the masjid, and she died one day. Prophet ﷺ asked about her, and they told him that she died at night, so we buried her. We didn't want to wake you up. So he actually went to her grave, and he prayed the janazah at her grave for her. He made dua for her. And also, the hadith that says, whoever eats the garlic and onions, he should not come to the masjid, because this would actually, this kind of smell would annoy the angels, just like it annoys the people who are in the masjid as well. And then when the Prophet ﷺ said that, he said one time, مَنْ أَكَ مِنْ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ الْخَبِيثَةِ شَيْئًا فَلَا يَقْرَبَنَّ مَسْجِدَنَا. Whoever ate from this, khabitha means bad, means he is referring to the bad smell. about this bad kind of tree, which is basically talking about the smell. Because, but it is, of course, beneficial from the nutritional point of view. And it is not haram. So when he said khabitha, some people said hurrimat, hurrimat. They understood khabitha here. Because khabitha could mean evil as well, by the way. Khabitha could mean, wa yuharrimu alaykum al-khaba'ith, right? Could mean evil or bad. But he was referring here to the smell specifically. So some people said, oh, it's become prohibited, it's become prohibited. The Prophet ﷺ responded, says, ayyuhan nas, O people, innahu laysa bi tahrimu ma ahal Allah. He says, I have no right to make haram what Allah has made lawful. But, وَلَكِنَا شَجَرَةٌ أَكْرَهُ رِحَهَا. But I hate the smell of the garlic and onion, of course. The odor, and even now if you get garlic tablets, it says what? Odorless tablets, right? Because everybody, most people don't like the odor of garlic. Now, also, people should not trade in the masjid, do make deals, financial trading deals in the masjid, that's prohibited. People should not make the masjid a place for advertisement and commercials. If somebody lost something outside the masjid, he shouldn't come to the masjid because to take advantage of the gathering and tell people, oh, has anybody seen my thing, or put an advertisement in the masjid looking for his thing, lost and found and things. This is not allowed in the masjid. He can do it outside. If he does it outside or puts the advertisement outside, that is okay, but not in the masjid.
If a person's wallet in the wudu area, and yeah, maybe he went back there and didn't see it.
You can come and talk to the imam, and the imam can maybe ask the people, that is fine. But that's what scholars said, that they said you can come and talk to the imam and imam will help you find it. But if we open the door for people looking for things in the masjid, basically this applies mostly to people losing things outside the masjid and coming because they know people on Friday, everybody is here. So they come and ask, has somebody found such and such? That becomes a big problem.
What about one for if someone outside?
No.
About what is to sell or to buy?
Yes.
If I told you with one for, I am in the masjid.
Yes.
Someone outside.
Yeah, no, should not happen. Should not happen as well because you're still doing a financial deal in there while you are in the masjid. No trading whatsoever. Also, it is prohibited to build the masajid in the places where there are graves. إِنَّ أُولَٰئِكَ إِنْ كَانَ فِيهُمُ الرَّجُلُ الصَّالِحُ فَمَاتُوا بَنَوْا عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ مَسْجِدًا وَصَوَّرُوا فِيهِ تِلْكَ التَّصَاوِيرُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ شِرَارُ الْخَلْقِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. أم حبيبة أم سلمة, the Sahabiyat, Umm Habiba and Umm Salama came to Prophet ﷺ from Habasha, from Ethiopia. When they migrated there, they came. And of course, it's a Christian country. At that time, it was only Christian country. So they came and said, they described to Prophet ﷺ that the places of worship had all these images. So he said to them, those people, whenever a righteous person died, they would actually build a place of worship on top of his grave. And then they would put all these images. He says, those are the most evil of the creation of Allah on the Day of Judgment. Okay? This is a big door and gate to shirk. We talked about this before. And that actually has happened in this ummah as well, to some degree. Also, tashbik al-asaba. When you come for the salah, once you have done the wudu and you're coming for salah, this is a kind of position that's there's nahi. Prophet ﷺ said you shouldn't do that, you shouldn't keep your fingers like this, coming to the masjid and waiting for the salah. But after that, you are. I'll mention the hadith to you. إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا توضأ أحدكم فأحسن وضوءه ثم خرج عامدا إلى المسجد فلا يشبكن يديه فإنه في صلاة. You are actually considered in salah from the time you have done your wudu. Even on your way to the masjid, you are in salah. Waiting for the salah, you are in salah. So this kind of position is prohibited in the salah and while you are waiting because you are considered in the salah. Okay? You're considered actually praying during that time. Almost done. But I will mention a couple of hadith from this other book here. We're good with time. Yes, an important point. Salatu bayn al-sawari. Sawari are these poles or pillars that you see in the masjid. For some, it is okay for somebody to pray between those poles if he's praying alone. But if we're going to make a line, there's a hadith in which Prophet prohibited or at least discouraged something like this. Let me read to you. كُنَّا أَن نُنْهَى مُعَاوِيَ بْنُ قُرَّةٍ He narrates on authority of his father, who is a sahabi. He says, كُنَّا نُنْهَى أَن نَصُفَّ بَيْنَ السَّوَارِي عَلَى أَهْدِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَنُطْرَدُ عَنْهَا طَرْضًا We used to be prohibited from praying between those poles. And the reason being is that you are going to cramp the line. One of two things. Either you're going to cramp the line, or you're going to make a separation in a line, a partition by that. And unless you absolutely need to, then you shouldn't. So if there's space, we should not make our lines between those poles that are holding the ceiling up. Okay, the pillars. But if there's no space otherwise, then that is fine. Okay. But so this is the reason. But to pray alone or for the imam to be between the poles, that is fine. There's a hadith in which Aina Salla Rasulullah, when he entered the Kaaba, actually, it has inside the Kaaba, it has those pillars as well. He says, they asked him, where did he pray? He said, between the two poles. So showing that it is allowed. Now, inside the Kaaba.
Only in Kaaba. Between?
No, in any masjid. For somebody praying alone, for somebody praying alone, or the imam, they can. Okay? Now, there's just a couple more hadith in this chapter, in this other book. Let me, hope I can find them. They add some more information about the masajid. أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن نتخذ مساجدنا المساجد في ديارنا وأمرنا أن ننظفها. He commanded us to build masajid in our diyar, which means our neighborhoods. So it's okay to have a masjid in each neighborhood where the people of that neighborhood makes it easy for them to come and pray. Now, and this could also mean في ديارنا, inside the house. You might have a place for prayer in the house. And we are commanded to make it وأن تنظف in some narration وتطيب. To make the scent good and to make it clean, and tidy. Okay. And also, you know the hadith of the man who urinated in the masjid. The Prophet ﷺ immediately told them they should be cleaned. And at that time, you know, some people had bad habits. They might spit. So Prophet ﷺ prohibited that as well in the masjid. Al-busaqu fil masjidi khati'a. To dirty the masjid, especially with something like that, a spit or something, that is khati'a, that's a sin, according to the hadith. Al-bay' al-shira' wal-nujdan al-dalla, we talked about this, not to trade in a masjid, not to raise your voice. Not to raise your voice will come, but not to look for something lost in the masjid. Raising the voice, that's important as well. One time Prophet ﷺ came in the masjid, he found the people reciting Quran loudly. He says the person who is praying is talking or having conversation with his Lord. فَلْيَنْظُرْ بِمَا يُنَاجِهِ وَلَا يَجْهَرْ بَعْضُكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ بِالْقُرْآنِ You should know what you're saying, and nobody should raise his voice over other people with the Quran. Okay. So even with the Quran, we should not raise our voices. So obviously, people should not have any kind of arguments or raise their voice in the masjid for worldly reasons. Now. But to talk, that's fine. As we mentioned, they used to talk about Jahiliyyah, and he used to allow them, and he used to smile, and they used to laugh. That's fine. If the shi'r, poetry, it's allowed to read lines of poetry in the masjid, as long as the content is decent, and the content is good. Husn al-Kalam. And that happened. There was no prohibition in that. Hassan ibn Thabit used to do that at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And one time, he did it at the time of Umar al-Khattab looked at him. He said to him, I used to do that in the presence of who is better than you, talking about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, also, al-akl wal-shurb wal-nawm. It is allowed to eat and drink in the masjid. كنا نأكل على عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في المسجد الخبز واللحم. Hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn al-Harith. And it is authentic. that they used to eat in the masjid, bread and meat. So eating in masjid, as long as you keep it clean, is still okay. Also, to somebody to sleep in the masjid is also allowed. There's a famous hadith in which Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu had an argument with his wife Fatima, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he left the house and he came to the masjid and he slept. And he slept on the ground. It was made out of earth. There were no carpets or anything. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, and when he called on him, he sat up or he stood up, and he was all covered with dirt from the side. He said to him, "Qum Aba Turab." Aba Turab is like a kunya. Says the man with dirt on him or something like this. Now,
with
earth. Or dust. And actually, Ali ibn Abi Talib used to like people to call him this name afterwards. Now, also Ashab al-Suffa, some people called Ashab al-Suffa, they had no houses. They're immigrants to Medina from Mecca, and they had no means of earning a living or money or houses or families or even wives or children. And they used to stay in the masjid, and they were plenty actually. And Abu Huraira was one of them, and that is how he gained all this knowledge. He was always in the masjid listening to everything being said, although he embraced Islam a bit later.
So he in Masjid al-Nabawi, it's still called Ashab al-Suffa.
Oh, Allah? Subhanallah. Adam ittikhadh al-masajid turuqan, people should not pass by the masjid. Like, you know, if sometimes there's a street here and a street here, and you know you're going to have to make a long turn to get to the other street. But then masajid, as you know, sometimes have a door here and door here. Yeah. So people shouldn't, say, let's take a shortcut through the masjid. No. That is, نَهَا لَا تَتَّخِذُ مَسَاجِدُ طُرُقًا إِلَّا لِذِكْرٍ أَوْ صَلَاةٍ. You don't go in the masjid to make it a road or a pathway. نعم. نهي عن تشبيك الأصابع, صلاته بين السواري, he talked about that. Okay, another point, النهي عن التزام مكان خاص من المسجد. Nobody should really assign, this is my place. This is Munir's place. We all know this Munir place. Huh? No, nobody should have a special place in the masjid. What? Still, nobody should have a special place for him. Naam. وَأَنْ يُوَطِّنَ الرَّجُلُ الْمَكَانَ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ كَمَا يُوَطِّنُ الْبَعِيرُ. يعرف الرجل مكان المعلوم المسجد خصوصا يصلي فيه كالبير لا إلا مبرك قد أوطنه واتخذه مناخا. Anyhow, nobody should take a certain place for him in the masjid. That's the place I come in, I do my sunnah in, I wait for the salah in. No, you should, people should switch different places. Now, inshallah, next time, inshallah, we'll talk about the places where we shouldn't pray, الأماكن المنهي عن الصلاة فيها. And then a sutra, which is to take something to block you from people passing in front of you in the salah. That's important. Maybe these two we can talk about next time. And then al-amal mubaha fi salah, I think. Yes. And then an important chapter after that. Maybe we can finish that as well. Things that you can do in the salah that some people think that you're not allowed to do. These are important. Those are coming, inshallah. Sophia.
Munir is usually here in the masjid all day.
Well, that's okay. He can take your place.
No, I'm saying about the ajr that he gets.
Yeah, mashallah.